So Prashanth is here. So he, as you know, has been with Adayar for the last few years, and now he's a professor in JIPMER. And he's the best person to talk to you on the cancer statistics and the clinical trials, because he has worked, you know, for almost 1.5 years in the phase one trial unit of MD Anderson. And that's the in place where you get all the new drugs in place and all the phase one trials. So he will tell all the nitty-gritties. And I'm sure there are at least two or three questions that you can expect, like the phase one clinical trial, the accelerated approvals, the many times that will be a short note in DNB as well as DM exams. So he will tell you the concepts of the same, and that would really help you in preparing for the theory exam. As a concept per se of masterclass, this is basically to give you a general idea on how to approach the theory-based examination. So that's what we are going to do in the next 1.5 years. We have the cream of faculty here. They'll teach you how to, you know, guide you in reading. That's all. We are not, you know, making tall promises that we're all your theory-related problems we can solve in 1.5 days and send back. No, that's for you to do all the hard work. But we'll try to guide you where you find some of these challenging topics, especially in places where there is DNB training. We thought this sort of guiding, this will help you in, you know what to read and how to read. And of course, as I told, these sessions have to be very interactive. So you need to tell us what you want us to tell you, and we will try to tell you in the subsequent sessions. And we have some interactive sessions per se for that this year, so you can keep your questions ready for the faculty during that session. So now, without much delay, we have the first speaker, Dr. Prashanth, who will take you through the clinical trials and statistics in oncology. Prashanth.
Thank you so much, Rajiv, for not just getting me here, but for the entire effort for this entire program. It is conceived very short notice, and all thanks to Rajiv for putting this all together for you people. Thanks for giving us a chance to interact once more. Last year's program was quite successful, and we got very good feedback from many of the postgraduates. So that's why I think we are going ahead with this program this year also. So, like Rajiv said, it's not possible to cover everything in your theory exam in this 1.5 days. So, we'll just give you a flavor of various things that you will be expected to know in your theory. So, that's what I plan to do here also. So, in the end, I'll just give you a list of topics which I think you may have to read. Then again, I don't think that I can cover all my slides here, because what we are trying to do here is, last year I had given a talk on clinical trials and research methodology, but the biostatistics part was covered by Dr. Senthil Rajappa. So I have got some. Because he gave a very fantastic talk, I think, last year. I don't think I can replicate that, but I'll try my best to give you a flavor of that also. So what I'm trying to cover here is, one is new drug development overview, phases of clinical trials, how the clinical trials are designed, what are the endpoints used. And then, if time permits, we will try to look at some basic statistics as it pertains to clinical trials. Okay. So, an overview of new drug development. Many of you are aware of this. How does a new drug come to the market? It's very, very important, pertinent for us when we are talking about oncology. So, there is something called a preclinical phase, when somebody thinks of a drug, in some laboratory they find some target, then somebody develops a drug for that. So, these are all happening in university hospitals, in the biotech labs. These things happen. Then some pharmaceutical company thinks there is promise for this drug. They pick up the drug, okay, and then it has to undergo a lot of preclinical testing in tissue cultures, in cell models, in animals. So the various testing. So this entire preclinical phase, which happens behind the scenes, and only when there is a lot of promise in the preclinical phase, it comes to the clinical phase. There is a lot of confusion even among medical oncology postgraduates. I ask them, and they tell that phase 1 is in preclinical, phase 0 is in preclinical. No confusion there. Talk about phase 0, phase 1, phase 2, phase 3. Everything is clinical. All the phases that we are talking about, it's all clinical. Okay. Preclinical is completely different. We are talking about phases of clinical trials. This is all clinical. Okay. There is nothing like phase 0 is not preclinical. All the phase 0, phase 1, phase 2, phase 3 is all clinical. They are having different concepts that we will come to. So, the process of drug development is a very long process, okay. So, the lead to discovery usually takes 5 to 6 years, and then the preclinical testing may take another few years, and when all this is completed, the drug company does something called an IND, okay. All these things can be short notes for you. I am just giving you the concepts. An IND means investigational new drug. Okay. The IND application is the first step before you can take a drug into clinical trial. So you have all this laboratory data and you have to submit an IND application to the regulatory authorities. In the US, it's the FDA. In India, the regulatory authority is, who's the regulatory authority in India? DCGI. Under the DCGI, there is something called CDSCO. Okay. So Dr. Adayar is covering all those things. So I'm not going into that. So once you have that, then you can get the drug into the clinical phase. Okay. So you have various phases. Now, these are the components of the IND application. Then again, I'm not going into it, but you have all the data from your preclinical studies which have to be submitted to the regulatory authority, and that must have single dose studies in two mammalian species. Okay, it's usually like a rat and a hamster or something like that. And with this data, you must have the LD10. This is very important. LD10 is the lethal dose in the 10%. So you keep increasing the dose in the mammalian species, and when 10% of them die with a particular dose, that is the LD10. Okay. So that particular dose you must get. And then you must also have data on repeated dose and chronic dosing, because the drugs will be used for a long time. So all this information is submitted, and then you go ahead with your phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, phase 4 studies. So this again, this is the drug development timeline. So what are these phases? Again, you all know, just recapitulating. Phase 1, what is the aim of phase 1? Anybody? What is the aim of phase 1? Sharda? Okay, it's not exactly safety, it is to find the dose. Okay, you must know what is the dose of this drug that I can use. Okay, that is phase 1. What is the dose I can use? Of course, you are looking at safety, but you want to know what is the maximum dose I can use of this drug. That is phase 1. Okay, phase 2 is? Efficacy. Phase 2 is efficacy, whether it works or not. That's phase 2. Phase 3 is to compare whether it's better than the current standard. Okay, phase 4 is after this thing, post-marketing surveillance. And as you need more and more participants in each phase. Now, we're going to discuss phase 1 clinical trials now. Okay. So, identify the best dose to be taken forward in phase 2 studies. You can have other endpoints in the phase 1 trial. You may want to develop some pharmacokinetic data. Okay. How the drug is metabolized, what is the area under the curve, all those things. You can get some pharmacodynamic data. Pharmacodynamic data is what targets are being inhibited. There you might have an assay which says how much BCR-ABL is blocked. Okay, so when you're giving various doses, you know how much BCR-ABL blockage I'm getting, how much PD-1 blockade I'm getting, how much immunological stimulation, how much I'm getting. This is all pharmacodynamic data. Okay, and you might get some efficacy signals also. It's not like in phase 1 you don't get efficacy signals at all, but that's not the primary endpoint. Even in phase 1, there are some drugs which are approved with phase 1. Can you tell one example? Crizotinib. Okay, crizotinib as a MET inhibitor in lung was approved with only the phase 1 data. Okay, they did want confirmatory studies, but the initial approval was based only on phase 1 data. Okay, so the phase 1 data does give efficacy signals sometimes. So why this phase 1 study in oncology is very specific is because our basic premise in oncology is always that more is better. Okay, if you keep increasing the dose of a drug, you keep getting better and better efficacy. This is the basic premise in oncology. That is the basis for all the cytotoxic drugs, which was the primary, that is the backbone of oncology therapy. You give more and more, you get more and more benefit. So you want to give as much as possible. Okay. So that is why these phase 1 studies are constructed this way. You want to try and give more and more drug. Okay. So this is the dose response thing. You want to get as high as possible. So the traditional model of a phase 1 clinical trial, you first start, at the same time you don't want to give any harm to the patient. Okay, so you start at a dose that is not expected to produce any serious toxicity. By tradition, again this is not based on any scientific principle, by tradition the starting dose in a phase 1 trial is 1/10 of the lethal dose in the most sensitive species. Okay, so in mice, when you study this, if 20 milligram per meter square dose in the mouse kills 10% of the mouse which have been treated with that drug, you start at 2 milligram per meter square when you start in the human beings. Okay, that is not expected to kill anybody. Okay, this is the starting dose. And the dose escalation goes in a series of pre-planned steps. And at each time, you must give some time. Okay, and this time is again arbitrary, but mostly it is one cycle. That is approximately 3 to 4 weeks. you give that much time to observe that group of patients before you go to the next level to see whether any toxicity emerges. Okay, this is how a phase is structured. I'll show you that. Before I come to this, let me just show you this. Okay. So this is the traditional model of a phase 1 trial, which is called the 3+3 model. Okay, this is the standard traditional model, and 90% of the phase 1 trials even now work on this model only. Okay. So how does this model work? You have your starting dose, let's say it's 2 milligram per meter square. You enter 3 patients. So the first patient comes, she's eligible for the trial. You put that patient, you give 2 mg per meter square of the drug. Okay, then you wait for one cycle. Okay, if the second patient comes after 1 week, that patient also goes into that. Third patient comes, that patient also goes. You have to wait till the third patient completes at least 1 month of your observation time. Then all 3 patients have completed 1 month. And in that 1 month, you want to see whether any of those patients develops what is known as dose limiting toxicity. This is the most important concept in a phase 1 trial, is dose limiting toxicity. Okay. So what is dose limiting toxicity? Dose limiting toxicity is defined as per your wish for that particular drug. Okay, you have a common definition, but it can be modified as per your particular drug that you are using. A dose limiting toxicity will usually say any non-hematological toxicity of grade 3 or 4. Okay, usually nausea, vomiting and diarrhea are not considered as dose limiting toxicity unless they are over and above your supportive care measures. Grade 4 neutropenia at least 7 days. Okay, because these are all from traditional cytotoxic therapy. So some neutropenia is expected, that automatically does not become a dose limiting toxicity. Okay, but if it is long lasting, that is more significant. So grade 4 neutropenia lasting more than 7 days. But now at the same time, if you are developing a drug for something like AML or something, this may not be a criteria. You understand what I mean? Because there you accept some more neutropenia. Okay, so this definition can vary depending on what kind of setting you are dosing the drug, but this is the traditional definition. Okay, any febrile neutropenia or documented infection, thrombocytopenia of grade 4, and if there is a delay of more than 14 days to start the next cycle due to toxicity, recovery from toxicity. So this is a conventional definition of dose limiting toxicity for a phase 1 trial. If any of these happen in a patient, So you enter 3 patients. If no patient developed any toxicity, let's say there is zero toxicity, then straight away you go to the next level. Okay, how we define the dose levels, I'll come to that. So you have defined the next dose level as 3 milligram per meter square. So the next group of 3 patients will get this at 3 milligram per meter square. Okay, again you will enter 3 patients. Suppose in those 3 patients, again there is no toxicity, no dose limiting toxicity. Then the next group of 3 patients. At each point when you enter 3 patients, you have to wait till the last patient completes at least 1 month before you go to the next level. These 3 patients don't stop the treatment. Okay, so you have entered 3 patients. These patients will continue the medicine next cycle, next cycle, next cycle till they develop any problem or progression. That goes on. But for entering the next cohort of patients, the first cohort should have completed at least 1 month of follow-up. That's how the whole thing works. Okay. Now, suppose in this 3, there was one patient who had some toxicity. Okay, so it's one dose limiting toxicity, that means 1/3. Okay. Then, at the same dose level, you enter 3 more. So now you have 6 at 2 milligram per meter square. Okay. Out of the next 3, suppose one more develops toxicity. That becomes 2 out of 6. Okay. Then you have to stop. Okay. That means you have established the maximum. Or you can see that this is the highest dose level that you can give, is that's all. More than 2/3 cannot develop toxicity. But at least 6 patients should have been enrolled at a level. 3 alone, you cannot say 1/3. If out of 6, 2 have developed, then you cannot escalate further. That means that's all, over. Okay. Then the dose level below that will be considered as the maximum tolerated dose. Okay. So suppose you went to 2 to 3 to 5, 6 milligram per meter square. At 6 milligram per meter square, 2 out of the 6 patients developed dose limiting toxicity, then the maximum tolerated dose was the dose level just below that. It's not the 6 milligram meter square which was the maximum tolerated dose. Got it? Okay. suppose that when you enroll three patients, out of three patients, already two patients develop toxic response. Then that's all, stop. Then no need to enter another three. Okay, then the dose level below will be considered as maximum tolerated dose. Some studies might have something called a dose level minus one. So at the zero level, you already have two out of three. They might enroll one level below just to make sure that at that level also you are not having that much toxicity. So they might have a minus one dose level just to be on the safer side. Okay, so this is how you determine the maximum tolerated dose. Now there are two concepts here. Okay, let's just finish this. What is this? This is the Fibonacci series. What is the relevance of Fibonacci series here? So the phase one dose escalation. So Fibonacci series actually is a very interesting series which was first discovered by somebody called Fibonacci. So it's the next number is actually the sum of the previous two numbers. So one, the previous number is also one actually. 1 plus 1 is 2. The next is 3. That is 2 plus 1 is 3. The next is 3 plus 2 is 5. 5 plus 3 is 8. So that's how the Fibonacci series goes. Okay, it's not actually, it's not what is written here. It's like 1, 2, 3, 5, 8. That's how the Fibonacci series goes. And 3 by 2 is actually 1.5. 5 by 3 is 1.5 something. 8 by 5 is 1.6. Okay, so this ratio, that is 1.5 to 1.6, approximately that ratio is the Fibonacci ratio. Okay, so your dose escalation is supposed to happen in that ratio. Okay, so if your first level was 2 mg, then the next will be 1.5 times 2 mg, that is 3 mg. The next will be 3 into 1.5, that is approximately 5. That's how this whole thing progresses. Why it is done like that? Absolutely no reason or rhyme for that. This is just traditional. Okay, so somebody started using the modified Fibonacci series for doing the phase 1 trials, and that's how it's been all these years. Okay, so it's not based on any scientific rationale. So the modified Fibonacci series is not exactly 1.6 or 1.5. There is some variation which happens, but approximately you keep increasing by 1.5 to 1.6 times at each dose level. So this is called the modified Fibonacci way of escalating the doses in the traditional phase 1 trial scheme. Okay. Again, this is for the traditional phase 1. There are other ways of doing phase 1. I'll just quickly touch upon that also. So we have already covered this. The couple of other important definitions that you know, again, all these things can be short notes for you. What is DLT? What is maximum tolerated dose? You might get a short note on that. So you must understand these concepts. So we already told what is dose limiting toxicity. That is something which is defined by you at the start of the phase 1 trial. Okay. Now, when more than 2/3 of the patients at a particular dose level develop dose limiting toxicity, 2/3 or more, then the dose level below that is called the maximum tolerated dose. Okay. Usually, the idea of conducting a phase 1 is to allow the phase 2 to happen. Right? You identify the dose and tell this is the dose you want to take forward in phase 2. Okay. The maximum tolerated dose can be considered as the dose for phase 2. Because you want to give as much as possible, no? So this is the maximum that you can give. So with this dose, you consider the phase 2. Okay, so the MTD can be the recommended phase 2 dose. So that is the next concept, that is RPTD, recommended phase 2 dose. Okay, conventionally, MTD can be the recommended phase 2 dose, but not necessarily. Okay, especially when you are talking about some modern medicines like targeted agents, for example, you need not always give the maximum tolerated dose. It's not necessary to give the maximum tolerated dose. So the maximum tolerated dose of imatinib may be 1200 milligrams, but you use only 400 milligrams of imatinib because you already find with your corresponding pharmacokinetic data that at 400 milligrams, I'm already inhibiting maximum BCR-ABL. By giving 800 milligrams, I have no advantage. It's not like a cytotoxic agent. Okay. So the recommended phase 2 dose can be the MTD, but it can also be lower than the MTD. Okay, so two are different. MTD could be the RP2D, but it need not be the RP2D. It can be lower than the RP2D also, especially when you are talking about target therapies, because you might dose based on some other endpoint. Okay, so this is concept called optimum biological dose. For targeted agents, MTD may not be reached at all. That is another problem. Sometimes you keep escalating the dose beyond a point. You are gone to 5th level, 6th level, 7th level. You are still not getting toxicity. That can also happen. Okay. So what dose do you take for second for your phase 2? When you never get a dose limiting toxicity, what do you do? So correspondingly, they will be doing correlative pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics, and you will find one level which is inhibiting your target. And that level you take it, that is called optimum biological dose. Okay. So all this can come out of a phase 1, and with that information, you recommend that, okay, this dose you can consider for phase 2. Sometimes what happens is, you might find that I'm not getting the maximum tolerated dose, or I'm not getting the dose limiting toxicity, and you find that the maximum inhibition is happening at, let's say, 400 milligrams dose. But 800 milligram also seems to be inhibiting well, not much of toxicity difference. But there should be 400 or 800, which should the dose I should take forward. That is when you conduct a phase 2, you will conduct a 2-arm phase 2 to pick the better one, because there you are looking at efficacy. So in the phase 2, you will actually run 2 arms and see whether the 800 is better than 400. Okay, so you can get a randomized phase 2 just to see which one is having better response rate, for example. Okay, so sometimes the final dose will come only after the phase 2. You need not always get the final dose after the phase 1. Okay. So now what are the other methods of dose escalation? There is something called pharmacologically guided method. So then you when you give a lower dose, you see what kind of area under the curve you get. And based on that, you derive, okay, instead of raising it by 1.5 times, I may raise it by 2 times, or I may raise it by 2.5 times. Okay. So that is pharmacologically guided dose escalation. You can also have a constant ratio increment. So instead of this 1.5, 1.6, you always increase by 2 times. So it's a faster, no? So this is something like an accelerated titration. So you don't want to waste so much time in giving subtherapeutic doses. The patient is not benefited. You are wasting a lot of time. So I'll show you that, because you need at least 5 or 6 dose levels for most patients, most drugs. So each dose level, you have to wait for 1 month for 3 patients to complete. So the whole phase 1 takes a long time to complete. The drug companies don't want that. No, they want faster reply. I mean, the world wants faster replies. So you make the whole phase 1 much faster. So you don't waste so much time. Another way to do it, at lower dose levels, you don't wait for 3 patients. You just put one patient at one dose level, no toxicity, immediately go to the next level. Only when you get the 3rd or 4th level, you start your 3+3 properly. So that is all accelerated designs. Okay. Then there is something called model-based approach, that is continuous reassessment method and Bayesian approaches, which is actually some kind of a complex statistics, which I cannot understand. Okay. But at each point, as each patient is recruited, and what is their toleration, you keep entering the data into a statistical model, which keeps suggesting the next dose for the next patient. So this modeling, they say that it's much faster than your usual traditional method, and you straight away get to the higher doses without much toxicity. Okay, there's nothing to, it's completely in the hands of the statistician. So all these methods are there, but again, I'm telling you, in spite of all these methods and whatever Divita might write on them, 90% of the trials, even now, are conducted based on the traditional 3+3. Okay. So what are the limitations of this traditional 3+3? One, the patient will not expect benefit. Your patient may be on the lowest dose level, which is absolutely subtherapeutic most of the time. Nothing is going to happen. The patient cannot expect benefit. Any patient will participate in a clinical trial expecting benefit. They are not doing it out of altruism. Okay, they want some responses when they participate in clinical trial, which you cannot expect when you are using this 1/10 of the LD10 alone. You are not going to get. So most patients do not benefit. Traditionally, if you look at all the phase 1 trials of cytotoxic to therapeutic this thing, the response rates in phase 1 trials are about 5 to 10% only. Most people don't get any benefit out of that. Okay. And you need to find this advanced cancer patient, because this is subtherapeutic, so you cannot put a patient with, you know, very early cancer which already having some other standard treatment. So you have to find somebody who has finished 5 lines, absolutely no other option, then only you can put a phase 1. But for that, the patient has to be healthy also. Difficult to find patients for phase 1. You have to be PS1, you have to have good organ function, everything has to be there. You must have advanced cancer. Difficult to find these patients. No, by the time they are usually down and gone. So that is one challenge. And prior therapy will influence the toxicity. Already patient has got neuropathy from his previous treatment. Now you get a new drug which causes neuropathy or side effect. again a problem. So these are all challenges. And MTD definition is very imprecise, and cumulative toxicity is never found out from phase 1 trials. Another big problem. Okay, the neuropathy you starts only after the third cycle. You are looking at only the first cycle. So how will you pick up the neuropathy? Okay, so these kind of things are the limitations. But still, this is one study which looked at how good are these phase 1s. So all these years we've been doing all these phase 1s. How good are these phase 1s ultimately when you look at these drugs which are based on phase 1? So they looked at about good number of drugs which were the 61 approved cancer drugs in the last few years, and looked at their phase 1 data and phase 3 data and compared whether the phase 1 was able to predict the toxicity which came out in phase 3. And surprisingly, almost the doses were similar, and 70% of the toxicities which happened in the phase 3 were already predicted from that phase 1 model. So again, this shows that this 3+3 model is actually pretty good. It's not perfect, but it's pretty good. So that's why people don't want to change this model. And the death rate with use of these drugs, use of this this dose which is predicted from the phase 1, and the death rate because of the drug was only 1.4%. So this model is pretty good. So as you can see, these are various cytotoxic agents which were approved over the years, and as you can see, all of them used the traditional method only. Okay, so traditional method, none of them used these fancy methods. And number of patients in these trials varied from about 20 to 50. This is the average range you find in a traditional phase 1. Number of dose levels, as you can see, can be very variable. So temozolomide 15 dose levels. You can imagine it would have taken a year to complete 15 dose levels, year and a half to finish 15 dose levels. It's not easy. Similarly, paclitaxel took 11 dose levels to complete. So you need a lot of time to complete a phase 1 trial. Okay. So what happens when you look at target therapies? So target therapies also, again, surprisingly, most of them traditional method. These are all 3+3. Okay. And some of them you stop because of the PK. That is the difference you can see here, not because of the toxicity. Because some of them you will never reach your dose limiting toxicity. They stop because you achieved certain PKs, you just stop it. And number of patient enrolled are similar. Dose levels sometimes even here, imatinib see 14 dose levels. And they stop because of the PK, not because they developed any toxicity. Okay. This is example of this very recent thing, anti-PD. I think this was nivolumab, I think. And the maximum tolerated dose again was not reached. They just stopped because they achieved some target inhibition. Okay. So targeted therapies, you may not get your MTD. So this we already covered. So there are newer trial designs, lot of pharmacodynamics, pharmacokinetics. So the newer phase 1s use a lot of different gimmickry to find the tolerated dose, because you're not really looking at cytotoxics anymore, right? So you're all newer drugs. So the models have completely changed, and these are various methods. So anything to, any queries here? On. So yeah, so this is very, this is not clearly defined anywhere. So different people use these terms interchangeably, okay. Phase 1A is what I just now described, very traditional way of 3+3, okay. Phase 1B, the term is used when you are using multiple dose levels in the same patient. Okay, that is sometimes phase 1B can be used for that. Sometimes you can use combination of agents, two agents together in the same this thing. So I'll give you an example. Suppose you want to combine gemcitabine with adriamycin. I'm just randomly I'm saying. So you already know some dose of gemcitabine, you already know some dose of adriamycin. So you're combining both, you want to find the optimum dose to combine. So you may be escalating both in each level. So you may escalate some of gemcitabine, keep the adriamycin constant. Next cycle, you increase the adriamycin, you keep the gemcitabine constant. So like that, you have a combination of agents trying to find out. That can also be called as phase B, 1B. I could not find a definite, because some last year also somebody asked me this question. I could not find a definite definition of phase 1B anywhere. This term, in many trials also they use phase 1B term. But when you look at the trial design, it looks like a traditional phase 1 trial design actually. So I don't know where that term comes. Nobody is clearly defining it. Okay. So I don't think there is anything much to go into that. Nobody will ask you what a phase 1B trial is. Okay. Don't worry about it. So this is again what I told you just now. That's why I put this slide here, because last year also I was asked this question, and I am not able to find a definite answer anywhere, to be very frank. Okay. Just a quick word on phase 0 clinical trials, because this is there in your DEVITA and this is very popular in your exam. Okay. So can anybody tell me what a phase 0 is? One tenth is phase 1 also is one tenth. One tenth of the LD only is phase 1. So it is lower than your one tenth. Okay, it is a very very minuscule dose. Okay, you don't expect any therapeutic benefit, zero. Okay, and you are not giving it to find any how many cycles I can give or nothing like that. Just giving it to find out what is the pharmacokinetics and pharmacodynamics. That's all. You give that, and then you are checking whether, for example, again EGFR is blocked or not, or PD-1 is blocked or not. Suppose you have an assay to see whether the PD-1 is blocked. You want to give this and see at this level whether the PD-1 is blocked, or you want to know when I give like this, what is the area under the curve, what is the half-life. I want to get that information only. For that, you can do a phase 0 trial. Okay. Patient should not expect any therapeutic benefit. Zero. Okay, because you are using very, very microscopic doses here. That is phase 0 trial. Okay. It is done prior to phase 1. Don't tell it is a preclinical. Okay. All are clinical, nothing preclinical about it. Okay. So understand the pharmacokinetics, pharmacodynamics and target localization. Very small dose. Okay, the starting dose is generally 1/50th the rat no observed adverse effect level. Okay, so there is something called no adverse event observed level in the rat. 1/50th of that I use. Okay, so you don't expect any therapeutic benefit here. It will be very minuscule doses. Patient cannot benefit from this. Usually about 10 to 15 participants only. So what is the advantage of phase 0? Why at all it was proposed? Again, this is not very popular. Not many drugs go through a phase 0. Okay. This is one example. This drug is ABT888, which is actually now called veliparib. Okay. So this drug, they did actually do a phase 0, which was published in 2009. They wanted to find the inhibition of the PARP using an assay, because this is a PARP inhibitor, right? And they found that at the 25 milligram and 50 milligram dose level, they are getting maximum PARP inhibition. Okay. So they did not do a phase 1 at all, because they never wanted to do single agent PARP inhibitor study. Okay. They wanted to do it along with some DNA damaging agent like platinum compound or something. They wanted to do the phase 1 with a platinum agent only. So they never did a phase 1 with single agent veliparib. Okay. So based on this, with 25 mg, 50 mg, they straight away went into phase 1 trials with combination with other DNA damaging agents. So they saved a lot of time by not doing a traditional phase 1 here. So this was one example where the phase 0 was successful. But beyond this, you don't find anything successful in phase 0. Phase 0 has not really kicked off the way people wanted it to. Okay, because everything may not correlate the way you want. You might not always have an assay for target this thing. Even if it inhibits the target, doesn't mean it's going to work. So a lot of problems are there. Okay. So but anyway, this is one example of a phase 0 trial. So it's non-therapeutic because of ethical issues. People may not want to participate. You are telling me it doesn't work. Why I should put my time and effort into it? I might as well take some other treatment, whether it may work. So it's very difficult to recruit people. And all are not suitable for phase 0. You need very severe resources like PK/PD. Insurance may not cover. Okay. And just because you got this, then they say some trials will say that previously you should not be exposed to PARP inhibitor, then only you can participate in this PARP inhibitor trial. So they participate in this, then they become ineligible to participate in the next PARP inhibitor trial, which may actually work. So all these reasons, it's very difficult to recruit patients in phase 0 trial. So it's not become very popular. Okay. So this is where I'm going to phase 2s. Anything, any doubts, any questions now? Nothing? Clear? Sorry about that. Sir, no, what's happening? Okay. So we already said phase 2 looked at efficacy. So that is the only aim of the phase 2. You can look at the efficacy in various ways: responses, progression free survival. This is the usual method. Some phase 2s can look at toxicity as an endpoint. Okay. And quality of life as an endpoint sometimes. Okay. But mostly it is responses and progression free survival. These are the usual endpoints in a phase 2 trial. So usually about 100 patients, usually it may go up to 300 patients, sometimes 50 patients, 60 patients. You are likely to take a more homogeneous population. Okay, now again you have to think of it from a pharmaceutical company point of view. Okay, all these drug trials are sponsored by pharmaceutical companies. When they do a phase 2, they want maximum chance of success. If it's not showing efficacy in phase 2, you're going to kill the molecule. Okay, that's all, it ends there. You develop, you put all this effort up to phase 2. If it doesn't work, that's all. The molecule ends there. Okay, so you want best chance of success. So when you select a population for phase 2, you take the best possible population. Okay, excellent performance status. Usually you don't want multiple lines of treatment. You will limit, you will say one line, two lines, that's it. You don't want somebody who's from fifth line or sixth line, because that fellow, whatever you give, he is not going to respond. Okay, the phase 2, that's why we keep saying phase 2 trials, be careful of the result. You cannot replicate what you find in phase 2 in phase 3, because the population in a phase 2 is always extremely selected. You take the best candidates here. Okay, and here's where they will look at target validation and all. They will try to select the population. This particular target is there, this is the population I want and all those things. So the companies are very careful when they select phase 2 studies. They must have measurable disease, because response rate is usually your endpoint. And this I already told. This is the standard phase 2 design, okay? This is usually what you will say is, I'll explain it better. We'll take it with an example. Suppose I want to do a phase 2 trial. This is just a random example. I want to study bendamustine in relapsed refractory ovarian cancer. I want to do a phase 2 to see what is the efficacy here. This is what I want to find out. If it is effective, then I may do a phase 3 comparing with the standard of care. Okay. Now, if I want to do this, what information should I have? How do I determine? The most important thing in a trial is your sample size. I must know how many patients I must give to see. So to determine the sample size, what information should I have? So I must know what to expect. No, if I give something else, what will I get? With that only I can build on it. Okay. So study population is clear. I take progressive ovarian cancer after one line of therapy. Whether I want a platinum refractory or platinum, that I can determine. Okay. Now my endpoint can be response rate, because I just want to know whether it is effective or not. Okay. I might have progression free survival also. So what's the sample size? So this is information from previous trials that in platinum resistant ovarian cancer, this is the response rate that I can expect. Topotecan is 33%, etoposide is 34%, whatever. Between, let's say, around 25 to 35%. This is what I can expect. Okay. If it is better than 35%, good. It is better than what I am doing right now. If it is below 25%, there is no point, because we already have drugs which are working better than that. So why do you want? So these are my two limits. So I should demonstrate that if I use this bendamustine, my response rate should be over 35%, or at least between 25 and 30%, or it should not be below 20%. Okay. So this means the regimen would not be of interest if the observed response rate is less than 20%. If I'll go to phase 3 if the response rate is more than 35%. This is how you will plan your study. Okay. Then you set your power and your type 1 error. Okay, and based on this, you can calculate the sample size using some statistics. So we don't have to know the statistics. Okay, you don't have to worry about the statistics. There are statistical tables available, like log tables. No, all these things are already been done. For a power of this and an alpha of this, this is the statistical table available. So this is one stage design. So you just set your lower limit and your higher limit. My lower limit is 0.2 and my higher limit is 0.35, 20% and 35%. For this, I will need a sample size of 50 patients. It's very simple, actually. Okay, this is all preset. You don't have to know the statistics. Okay, so if 50 patients I recruit, I will get my answer. Okay, below 50 patients if I recruit, I'll get some answer, but I won't get the statistical significance that I want. So at least 50 patients I should recruit. Now, suppose I'm using some other drug where my expectation is 0.5 and 0.7, for example. Okay, so then I'll just see here. Okay, very simple. So I need about 37 patients. My lower limit is 0.5, upper limit is 70%. Okay. Now suppose I want to keep it as 0.7 and 0.65. No, I will narrow down my thing. Below 65% I will discard it, above 70% I will take it. So only 5% gap is there. I need 548 patients to answer that question. So anything in statistics, if the gap narrows, then your sample size goes up hugely. So this applies to phase 2 also. So okay. So But generally, you don't do things like that in phase two. You are expecting some better thing. No? That 10%, 15% difference is there, then only you will try a molecule in phase two. Otherwise, you won't even take it there. With 5% all, you cannot demonstrate. Okay. So this is how this phase one, this is one stage design. Okay, one stage. That is 50 patients straight. I'll start with patient number one. I'll stop my trial only after 50 patients. Okay, this is one stage design. Now, there is something called two-stage design. Okay. In two-stage design, I don't wait for all 50 patients before I say, okay, in 50 patients, less than 20% responded, though this drug is useless, I'll stop my study. Okay. Now, why did you recruit 50 patients? You wasted a lot of time. Okay. Suppose after 30 patients itself, I could have made the conclusion, then I could have saved a lot of time. So that's why you have this phase two-stage design. In two-stage design, you have two cutoff time points, and you will pre-specify at each point how many responses you want to either reject it or take it further. Okay. The same example, the alpha error of 0.05, power of 0.8, okay. 0.2 is the lower limit of your response and 0.35 is the higher limit of your response. Again, this calculation is done by online statistical calculation. You don't have to know anything about how this is done. What it says is, your total recruitment is 53 patients, approximately 50 what we calculated in the stage 1. But in the stage 1, you recruit 39 patients. Okay. Out of this 39, if less than 9 respond, then you reject. Stop. You don't have to recruit more. It's useless. Even if you recruit 53 patients, this is what you are going to get. Don't take the drug further. If in the first stage, if you get 15 patients responding, okay, then you take, you are, this is actually very good. No? Then also you can stop. Because already good, you stop it here, you take it to phase 3 straight away. If it is 9 and 15, then you complete your 53 patients and see. Okay, this is called two-stage design. Understand? So some trials they'll do a one-stage phase 2, some trials they'll do a two-stage phase 2. Okay? Two-stage is always better because you save some time. Because sometimes you find it very fast, then you don't have to waste your time doing the entire phase 2. Okay. So this is traditional one-arm phase 2 design. In addition to this, there is something called randomized phase 2 also. Okay, this we already said. So you might have a randomized phase 2, you might use progression-free survival instead of response rate. The principles are the same. In randomized phase 2, your sample size calculation is very similar, only but you will have two arms. Okay. Now the question comes, what is the difference between a randomized phase 2 and randomized phase 3? This is always the confusion actually. Why? What is the big difference? You are always, here also you are looking at PFS, there you are looking at OS. The difference is in the sample size. Okay. So this example, say the standard therapy A, the median PFS is 6 months and median overall survival is 2 years. This is what you have right now. Now, I have a new therapy where I am expecting 25% reduction in the hazard of death. That translates into a 4 month increase in the median overall survival. Okay. No? Now, a phase 3 trial with 90% power with a two-sided 5% alpha requires 510 deaths to find out this significance, and 50% would have events in 2 years. So the number to be randomized is actually 1000. So with 1000 patients, I can prove or disprove whether the new drug is better or worse. Okay, this is how the sample size calculation goes. If I do a phase 2, I'm not powering it to the overall survival. I'm powering it to only the PFS now. Okay, so to detect a 33% reduction in the hazard of progression, corresponding to a 2 month increase in PFS, the one-sided significance of 10%, I need only 164 events. Here I needed 500 plus events. An average follow-up of 2 years, 90% would have had these events. So here the sample size is only 180. Okay. But you can make only this much conclusion on it. So this is the difference. So why sometimes you have phase 2 randomized, sometimes you have phase 3 randomized, is mainly for the sake of your sample size. Okay. Phase 3 requires huge sample size. Phase 2 requires small sample size. So when you do a randomized phase 2 is because again, when you are confused, the company is confused whether I want to invest my full money in a phase 3 randomized trial and waste so much money and then I find out it's not useful. No? Then let's do a phase 2 randomized and see. So 180 patients, I'll get some idea. Then okay, it's worth it, then I take it to a phase 3. Okay, so this is all, it's all economics. Because a full-fledged 1000 patient phase 3 RCT may run into millions of dollars for a company. So they will do a phase 2 RCT, then do. What is the other scenario where you want to do a phase 2 RCT? So sometimes, no, I told you already, you have two dose levels. You are not sure which dose level to pick. So you want to see whether these two, in phase one you found two dose levels, you are not sure which one to pick, you do a phase two RCT to pick one dose level. Okay. You might, some two therapies look very similar, you just want to differentiate between those toxicity. So you might do a small phase two RCT just to make sure the toxicities are same or different. Okay. So these kind of situations also you might do phase two RCT. So there are various types of phase twos. Just to again summarize, phase one is very simple, no complicated statistics in phase one. Okay. Can address first in human as well as approved agents in new combination. Phase two, it's easier and faster to do than phase three. And the outcome analysis must be interpreted with caution because one, I told you are powering it to a not a very robust endpoint many of the time. Second thing is your choice of patients in a phase two are much more selective than in a phase three. Phase three is also selective. Any patient who goes on a trial is selected. It's not a patient you see in the clinic. But there is in phase two, patients are highly, highly, highly selected. By necessity, they are selected. Okay. So you can never replicate the phase two data in a phase three. You can never replicate the phase 3 data in your clinic. So be careful when you are interpreting phase 2 data. So you should not jump and change therapy based on phase 2 data. You won't get that. Okay. So this is, I have ended phase 1 and phase 2. Any doubts? Any questions, clarifications? Again, this phase 2, phase 2B, there is some confusion. Again, what I can understand is this is not defined anywhere. Phase 2, your traditional design, anything which is not the traditional design, like a randomized phase 2, those kind of things are sometimes called phase 2B. Okay, so that is, there is something called phase 1/2 trials. Phase 1/2. Okay, 1-2 trials. So those are trials in which the phase 1 and 2 are incorporated in the same trial. So normally you do a phase 1, find this thing, then you do the next trial for the phase 2. Okay, sometimes you don't want to do that. You do the phase 1 and with the maximum tolerated dose, you straight away go on to phase 2. Two advantages, you don't have to go through the regulatory process again. So you save that time. Second advantage is, whatever patients you have recruited at the maximum tolerated dose, those patients can be used for the analysis of the phase 2, for the efficacy analysis. So you save time both ways. So that is the rationale for the phase 1/2 trials. Sometimes you can do that also. Okay? Anything else? Right. So we come to phase 3. So here, you cannot cover all aspects of phase 3. These are the things that I would expect you to know when you are going for the exam. I am not going to cover all these topics. Okay, the slide set is there. Some of these things are already there in your slide set. I am not showing that here. Okay, you must know about trial designs. We will cover a bit of that. What are the trial endpoints? What is randomization? Each of these can be a short note in your exam. Okay, what is randomization? What is meant by placebo controlled? What is stratification? What do you mean by intention to treat analysis? What is a data safety monitoring committee? What is subgroup analysis? What is survival analysis? What is Cox regression analysis? Univariate and multivariate analysis? What is a consort? What is a consort diagram? What is a consort statement? What do you mean by conflicts of interest? And some statistics like what is alpha error, beta error, power, risk reduction, hazard ratio, number needed to treat. All these things you must have some idea, you must be able to write one page on any of these topics. So I will suggest that you all prepare and keep. Okay, there are plenty of resources available in the net. Just prepare and keep so that you can write something. Okay, don't write nothing. All these can be asked, will be asked. One of these things will be there in your theory paper. I'm pretty sure of that. Okay, I'll cover some topics. First thing I want to cover is endpoints in clinical trials. Okay. You know, variety of endpoints. You must know the endpoint is dependent on your primary objective. Okay, whatever is your objective of your trial, based on that you have to set your endpoint. Okay, now, so tumor response is usually not a good endpoint in phase 3 trials. Why? All these things here. Phase 3 trials, your objective is to find whether some drug is better than the other drug. But drug is better not just mean it is responding better. Okay, it should ultimately result in patient living longer, patient living better. Okay, so from that point of view, tumor response is not good because most of the time a response may not correlate with survival. It might, but doesn't mean something is responding better, some mean the patient is going to live well, live longer. Okay, it seems intuitive, but there are meta-analysis which have been done in advanced cancer patients where it has been clearly shown that tumor response always does not correlate with survival. Okay. Second thing is, it is always dependent on measurement issues. Treatments which response doesn't correlate with survival at all, like targeted therapies, So, for example, bevacizumab may show survival advantage, but bevacizumab never produces responses. Sorafenib in hepatocellular carcinoma hardly produces responses, but does produce some survival advantage. Many of your immunotherapies may not produce any responses, or may produce some pseudo progression also, but they will produce survival advantage. So you cannot use response rate as an endpoint in a phase 3 clinical trial most of the time. Metronomic therapy again, it's an anti-angiogenic or immunomodulatory therapy. You don't get responses, but the patient lives longer. Okay, so you never use response rate. You mostly use PFS. Okay, again, this is another thing which keeps getting asked. What are the problems and what are the advantages of using PFS as a endpoint? Some of you can tell. What are the problems with using PFS as an endpoint? Depends on the timing of the evaluation. Good. That what that means is, in some trials you may do the response evaluation once in 3 months. In some trials you may do it every 2 months. Okay. So somebody, if it's a very rapidly progressing tumor and it has progressed within 2 months, but if you are going to do the scan only after 3 months, then you show the PFS duration as 3 months, whereas actually it was only 2 months. But if you had done the scan at 2 months itself, you would have picked it up at 2 months. Okay, so how the trial was constructed can artificially lengthen or shorten the PFS. Understand? Because when you do the scan only, you will pick up the progression. No, so you're doing the scan only at 3 months. You will automatically say 3 months the patient has not progressed. If the patient has actually already started progressing in 2 months, if you had done the scan at 2 months, you would have picked it up. So depending on where, how you space your scans, you can artificially lengthen or shorten your PFS. So we are telling advantages and disadvantages compared to overall survival. In overall survival, you cannot do all those things. No, dead, alive. So it's very simple. In PFS, you have that problem. Second, the problem with PFS is you are dependent upon responses. Again, okay. Responses means you must have measurable disease. So if you don't have measurable disease, only pleural effusion is there. How can you measure that? You cannot measure, no. So only those with measurable disease, you can do PFS. Overall survival, you don't have to worry about that, dead or alive. So PFS is not always a surrogate for overall survival, that we all know. Okay. Third, and minor PFS differences, how it matters. This is 2 months, this is 1 month. What is the ultimate impact on overall survival? Nobody knows. Okay. And immunotherapy can cause pseudo progression. Then what do you do? Okay. You use nivolumab, some pseudo progression. How do you call it? What do you do with it? You don't know. Okay. So any drug where there is lesser PFS but more overall survival? Immunotherapy, not really. Eribulin?
Yes.
The PFS was lesser and overall survival was more?
Yes.
Okay, that's one example. Another was that prostate cancer, that vaccine,
Sipulucel.
The PFS was actually shorter, but the overall survival was more and it got approved based on that. So some weird things can happen actually.
Just hold on, Prashant. So just an announcement that, you know, we are providing all the slide sets to you. We are sharing all the slides. So don't,
really.
Raghu was suggesting don't take pains of, Photoshop, photosnapping it. We are going to give all the slide sets, either through WhatsApp or email, we'll send it to you.
There are much more slides than what I'm showing here actually. So what some other topics also I put into that. Because of time, it's not there. So this is one example where PFS should not replace OS as endpoint. Okay, so some of you may be aware of this. In 2007, we had the results of this ECOG study comparing Bev plus chemo versus chemo alone in metastatic breast cancer. The PFS was 11 months versus 5 months favoring bevacizumab. There was no difference in overall survival. It was submitted to the FDA, and in December 2007, FDA approved bevacizumab for metastatic breast cancer. Okay, and this is an accelerated approval. And for the next 3 years, Roche sold a lot of bevacizumab actually. They made a lot of money on bevacizumab. Two more studies were conducted in this period. One was the Avado and the Ribbon. And both of them, there was less than 1 month difference in the PFS. Here there was some 1.2 months, no difference in OS. And finally, in July 2010, they voted against the approval of bevacizumab, and the approval of bevacizumab was withdrawn for metastatic breast cancer. You have to be very careful when you're interpreting things like this. And jumping and starting to use drugs, some drugs which are extremely expensive or if they are too toxic. Okay, not always translate into survival. Okay, so this was a very controversial thing at that point of time. So I'm just telling you that PFS may not always be the best endpoint. But there are reasons for us to use OS, PFS, because multiple therapies, so you can never really find the OS. It's very difficult to do OS in some long-standing tumors and all those things. The advantages of OS are there. It's simple to measure, unambiguous. Relevance is very good. It's non-invasive. And even if somebody misses the follow-up, you can always call up and find out the overall survival. So these are the advantages of OS. So I'll just skip this part. Again, this is another thing which I'll just show you, the problem with doing OS. So in the panitumumab trial, these are both trials are very similar in metastatic colorectal cancer when they originally did. In the panitumumab trial, they allowed crossover. So they kept the PFS as the endpoint. They did not find any overall survival difference. Whereas in the cetuximab trial, there was no crossover. The OS was significantly different. So the cetuximab was much more popular in the beginning. Now maybe both drugs are used simultaneously, but it seemed like cetuximab produces overall survival advantage and panitumumab does not. So that is one of the problems. You have to interpret trials with a lot of caution and lot of care actually. Sometimes you can have phase 3 trials with quality of life as an endpoint. So this is an example. So this is the AML 17 trial where it was completely powered on quality of life comparing arsenic ATRA versus chemotherapy plus ATRA in APML patient. So this is they did have secondary endpoints as other things, DFS and OS, but the primary endpoint in this trial was actually quality of life. So you can use whatever you want as long as it's all justified and statistically clean. Okay. So you choose your endpoint depends on what you want. Mostly adjuvant therapy trials use DFS. In curable lymphomas like Hodgkin's or non-Hodgkin's, you can use either DFS or something like EFS. In low-grade lymphomas, you use progression-free survival. One curious endpoint is FFTF. Okay, FFTF is an endpoint used in Hodgkin's trials, particularly by the German Hodgkin study group. Can somebody tell me what this FFTF is? How is it different from EFS or PFS or freedom from treatment failure? Okay, event-free survival also you will define event as relapse or progression or death. So why do they not call it EFS and why are they calling it FFTF? What is the difference between FFTF and EFS? Toxicity? No. Actually, the one more definition in the FFTF is that non-achievement of CR was considered as failure of treatment. Because when you're treating a curable cancer, you want CR to be achieved. If you're not achieving CR in Hodgkin's, you already failed your treatment. So the FFTF, in addition to an EFS definition, you also include non-achievement of CR. That is the difference. Okay. And another thing is depending on how you define, okay, the same PFS may be defined differently in different trials. Okay, this is an example where the same EFS and PFS was defined differently in the IRIS trial, investor and some trials conducted by the MD Anderson. So some people said only AP or B blast crisis is progression. Some people call loss of cytogenetic response as progression. Some people call molecular response loss as progression. So you can define whichever way you want. So this was an interesting paper where they used the same cohort of patients and analyzed their survival using the different definitions in different trials, and they could show different PFS for the same cohort of patients. So again, be cautious when you are reading these papers, when you are analyzing these papers, what definitions has been used, what has been called as PFS. And again, when comparing across trials, be very careful. Okay, so the same cohort can be shown to have different EFS by using different definitions. Okay. So now we move on to trial designs. Okay, this is something which I again wanted to show you. So you have basically three types of trials in phase 3. One is superiority, one is non-inferiority, and third one is equivalence. Equivalence is very rarely done, practically is almost not done. Mostly you get either superiority trials, most of the trials, and sometimes you get the non-inferiority design. Okay. Now, so again, this comes back to statistics. Generally, you will have some null hypothesis which says that there is no difference between treatment A and treatment B. And if you find the difference, you reject the null hypothesis and accept that there is a difference. And the difference is superior, it is superior. The difference is non-inferior, it is non-inferior. Same concept applies here. So null hypothesis is that C is superior to T. This is generally. The rejection of the null hypothesis or the alternate hypothesis is that this is the treatment is not inferior to the control. So you want to achieve this. This is what your trial is aiming for. And this is your null hypothesis that there is no difference. Okay. Now, so you might get all these outcomes in a non-inferiority trial. Sometimes in the non-inferiority trial, the treatment arm lies way beyond your non-inferiority margin. Okay, so in these situations only, you can actually claim superiority. If it crosses completely on the other side, the confidence interval is completely on this side, then you call it is superior. In all other situations, you call it non-inferior. If it crosses this side, okay, the new treatment is worse. If the confidence interval is crossing on this side, it's completely here, it's inferior. Most of these would be called not inconclusive because you have very wide confidence interval. You should not be getting that if you have enough sample size. You should not be getting such a wide confidence interval. But theoretically, this is how you would call the trial. Either should be like this or one of these or this. This situation you get when you are having too small a sample size because the confidence interval becomes too wide. Okay, so you can get all these different interpretations in a non-inferiority trial. But sometimes a non-inferiority trial can be used to call superiority if it is really on the other side. Okay. Now, this is an example of a non-inferiority trial which just came out 2-3 months back, the IDEA trials, where they tried 3 months versus 6 months of adjuvant therapy for colon cancer. So the huge number of patients, because they put together multiple trials here, and almost 12,300 patients. See, what happened was non-inferiority of 3 months versus 6 months was not confirmed because, as you can see, the confidence interval was 1.0 to 1.15, where they initially specified the hazard ratio did not exceed 1.12. Here it went to 1.15. So the primary this thing was not met, but they had enough patients so they could do a proper subgroup on this, where they looked at only patients treated with capox. And here the confidence interval was 0.85 to 1.06. So it did not reach 1.12. They finally concluded that those who are getting capox, you can get away with 3 months, and not for those who are getting FOLFOX. So this is how they interpreted the whole trial. But here it's valid because the number of patients were huge. So you can make all these conclusions. But be careful. You have very small number of patients and you are making all these conclusions. Okay. Again, I'm just telling you how these non-inferiority trials are this thing. So this is a very old trial which was done in good prognosis germ cell tumors. The expected prognosis is about 90%. So they wanted to reduce the toxicity. So the easy way to reduce one cycle of BEP. So from 4 you make it 3. So the Southeastern Cancer Study Group was designed to show a less than 10% difference of 3 versus 4 BEP. So 184 patients. What they found was 92% DFS in both arms. But the non-inferiority limit was set as 10%. So they accepted a 10% difference in the DFS. But suppose the difference was between 5 and 9%, this trial could not have shown that. Okay. So 10% means it can show the non-inferiority. 5 and 9%, it cannot show the non-inferiority. So they had to run another trial, which was the MRC-ERTC combined trial, to rule out a difference of 5% or more in the PFS at 2 years with 90% power. For this, they needed, they needed 774 patients. So as you cut down your non-inferiority, your number of patients go up. And they needed to do two groups had to combine to complete this trial. But ultimately, they did show in this also that 3 BEP is equal to 4 cycles. Okay. But I'm just telling you, so the sample size is the most crucial thing here and depends on what kind of margins that you are looking at. Now, this is an example of non-inferiority trial used to claim superiority. Okay, so this is a Calypso trial which compared pegylated doxo plus carbo with paclicarbo in relapsed platinum-sensitive ovarian cancer. And here it was originally constructed as a non-inferiority trial because they wanted to show that PEG is less toxic than this. But ultimately, they finally claimed or concluded that this was the hazard ratio was way on the other side. They concluded that this one not only met the non-inferiority, but the CD was superior to CP. I'm just giving you examples of various trials from the literature. But these are traditional trial designs, what I showed you till now. But the problem with traditional trial designs is that the historically oncology compounds have very low success rate. Okay, so you do all these things and finally you find that some compound is not working. So you waste a lot of time, lot of money, lot of energy. So you need some trial design where you can get the success faster. So the newer trial design, what you are talking about is from this 5% success rate. So you want to increase the success rate. So you use predictive markers, biological markers. So you have newer trial designs. You can probably accelerate this whole process of drug development. So this is biomarker based drug development. The examples of success are crizotinib in lung cancer, where you focused on a population of MET and you found it. Imatinib in CML, trastuzumab, vemurafenib. All these are biomarker based drug developments. So this is again, I'm just putting it so that you can get these questions in your exam. What is a basket trial and what is an umbrella trial? Okay. In an umbrella trial, you take one type of cancer with different genetic mutations and put all of them into one trial. So you might have lung cancer trial you have one standard arm, but on the experimental arm you might use for ALK positive you use this, for EGFR positive you use this, some other positive I use this. So multiple things all together in one trial. So this is called an umbrella trial. But a basket trial, you are focused on one mutation. So you have some RAF inhibitor, so you catch a colon cancer with RAF, you get a melanoma with RAF, you have lung cancer with RAF, everything you put together into one basket. So that is called a basket trial. Okay, there are examples of all these trials. I put it in your slide set, but I am not showing it here because we don't have time. So we just come to the end of the trial designs and this thing. The other things that you should know in clinical trials, so I hope you all read up. How much time do you have? We'll start with sir. Then yeah, we'll come back to it. So I'll stop here. Okay. Any quick questions at this point of time? Yeah, stupor. Okay. Thank you. I'm sure you're getting the right person to wake you up, so. In 2004 and 2006, these were treated in a particular institute. In 2008, out of these 200 children, 100 are still on follow-up and are alive. 50 have died and 50 were lost to follow-up. So what is the overall survival? This is what you want to know. We cannot say that 100 are alive, therefore the survival is 50%. No, we cannot say that. No, it's not so simple, because there are some patients who are having longer follow-up, some are having shorter follow-up, right? So how do we say it's 50%? We cannot say that. Okay. So a factor, it's not just this by this. There is a factor of time which has to be incorporated into the survival analysis. That's why it becomes complicated. So how long a person has been on follow-up? Okay. So that is where the concept of censoring comes. Okay. All patients, how much they survive, we have not observed. Because some patients started in 2006, some patients started in 2004. You cannot observe all their survival times. You don't know how much exactly it is going to be. So the event of interest does not take place in these subjects. Somebody has not relapsed or somebody has not died. Doesn't mean they are not going to die in the future. Okay, so we don't know how long it will take for them to die. So at that point, we can say that till that point they have not died, or till that point they have not had the event. So at that point they are censored. So this is the concept of censoring. Okay. So if you don't take the censoring into account, you create a lot of bias. Okay. So you don't know, why you censor? Because you don't know the exact survival time of a person. The study ends at this point, the patient has not had an event, so he is censored at this point. If you had followed him for some more time, he would have probably had an event. Okay, so this is the concept of censoring. So any patient who has not had an event when the study ends, or patient who withdraws from the study before this at any point of time, or is lost to follow up, all these are censored in a survival analysis. So a raw data for, let's say, two groups of leukemia patients, you can have some patients who had events. These are all patients who had events at 6 months, 7 months, 10 months. Each of them represents an individual patient. There may be some patients who are censored at 6 months, 9 months, 10 months, 11 months. So this is the raw data that you get. No, each person's survival, when you put it on an Excel sheet, this is how the raw data looks. And this is the group 2. And there I have another set of raw data for group 2. Say all of them have had events, so nobody has had a censoring in this. Okay. So what you do is, you have to put this in a like a tabular form. So you will say the first individual 6 weeks, whether he failed or he got censored. Second individual at 6 weeks, failed or censored. So this entire raw data is put in the form of a table in a sequential manner. At each time point, what happened? At 6 months, one person censored, one person had an event. Or nobody censored, nobody had an event, something like that. So this is actually called a life table. Somebody asks you, life table is just a tabular representation of all the patients in a particular study, okay, along with whether they had an event or whether they were censored. Okay, so this is the life table. So this is another example here. Let's say at each time interval, 0 to 1 month, we started with 7 patients in this particular study, and in this time period, 0 patients were censored, but 1 person died. Okay, so if you start here, this is the 0 time point. At 0 time point, all 7 patients are alive. Nobody has an event. Okay. So your survival is 100%. One. Now, when you come to the 1 month time point, at this time point, out of six, out of seven, one patient died. Okay. So what happened here? The proportion which is surviving is 6 out of 7, that is 0.86. Okay. So that's what happens at 1 month time point, your survival drops to 0.86, that is 86%. Okay. Now you are continuing to follow up this cohort of patients. What happens is at 2 months and at 3 months, two patients got censored. They did not have an event, but for some reason they are censored. Okay. So when they are censored, they do not constitute an event, the survival curve does not drop. Okay. So they are censored, but at 4 months time point, one person has had a death or an event. Okay. So when you recalculate at the 4th month time point, that is here, you have to calculate it as out of the 6 patients now, 2 have been censored, so you are left with 5. Sorry, you are left with 4. Out of the 4, only 3 are surviving because 1 has died. Okay. So finally, the proportion who are surviving from this is 3 out of 4, that is 75%. But from the proportion of total who are surviving, that is 75 out of the 0.86, because you are looking at the next time point. So your cumulative survival at the end of 4 months is 0.86 into 0.75, that drops is 0.64. So that's what your curve will be now. So here one drop, here one drop. Similarly, for each time period, you will have censoring, you will have actual events. And this one, this 0.86, 0.64, 0.31, 0.31, which represented on this graph to their corresponding time points is your survival curve. Okay. So you have the life table. The life table calculates the cumulative proportion surviving at each time interval. This, when represented graphically, becomes the Kaplan-Meier curve. This is how you are doing the survival analysis. Understood? Got a basic idea? So this is a very small number of patients, so it looks like a very big drop in the curve. But when you have like 200 patients, this curve will look much smoother. Okay, when it looks much smoother, you don't know at where all people got censored. So they will have these small tick marks or plus marks in these curves to know where all people got censored. To know what is the difference between an event and a censoring. When you have somebody censored, the curve does not drop. But when you have an event, the curve will drop. Okay, again, the depth of the drop, here also there is one person who died, here also one person died, but you can see the drop here is much smaller than the drop here because the proportion who are alive here are much lesser. So towards the tail end of the curve, because the number of patients who are having that long a follow-up is much lesser, any event which happens towards the tail end of the curve will produce a much larger dip than which happens in the beginning of the, because there is a lot of patients surviving. 6 out of 7 is only a 0.1% drop or 0.15% drop, whereas 1 out of 2 is a 50% drop. You understand? For this reason, when you analyze Kaplan-Meier curves, you should be very careful about interpreting anything which happens towards the tail end of the curve. So ideally, to interpret a Kaplan-Meier curve, you must have at least 1/3 of the initial number on follow-up. Beyond that, the Kaplan-Meier curve should not be interpreted. Understand? If you have 300 patients, you must have at least 100 patients who are on follow-up. Beyond less than 100 patients, don't interpret the curve too much because it is very vulnerable to small variations. Okay. Now, from the Kaplan-Meier curve, you can estimate the proportion who are surviving at a given point of time. Okay. So, 5 years, you draw a line like this and you extrapolate the line here, you know it's 30% survival. Okay. So you have the cumulative survival from the life table. With that you make your Kaplan-Meier curve, and from the curve you estimate survival at 5 years, survival at 2 years, like that. Okay. So this is, you say at 5 years 30% survival, at 2 years 50% survival. The time at which 50% are surviving is your median survival. Okay. So when you are calculating median survival, if you are doing thesis, we are doing some analysis, it is not, you have all your overall survival in your Excel sheet. You do not take the median of that and say median survival is this much. It doesn't work that way. Okay, because that is not the correct survival. Because some of them are censored, some of them are true survivals. Because some of them might be just censored data, no? That overall survival is just censored data. So you should calculate the median survival only from the Kaplan-Meier curve. It is not the median of all your overall survival numbers. Understood the difference, what I am saying? Okay. So the median survival comes from the Kaplan-Meier graph, and not by taking the median of all your overall survival numbers. Okay, it has to be from the survival analysis only. Okay, this I already told you what the tick mark represents. Now, this is another thing. This is again what I told you just now. This is the number at risk at each time point. How many? This is from the life table. I showed you the life table. The life table has been extrapolated here to know the number at risk. So this trial, this is the IPASS trial. In the IPASS trial, you started with 600 patients of gefitinib and 600 patients of carboplatin in non-small cell lung cancer. So what I meant is, beyond this point, and at least one third, that's 200 patients, beyond this point, the curve is not interpretable. Don't take too many things beyond this point. This has no relevance. This is not meaningful. The curve should be interpreted only up to this point. Beyond that point, don't interpret too much on the curve. Okay, so that is why this number at risk is very important. All journals do not insist on the number at risk. NEJM always has the number at risk. Okay, so that you can interpret the whole thing better. Other interesting thing from these kind of curves is, one, what is the interesting thing here in this curve is the crossover. So there are many things you can interpret from a curve. When you see a crossover in the curve, it means subgroup effect. Okay, when the IPASS trial was originally conducted, it was not selected for EGFR selected patients. It was gefitinib versus paclitaxel in Asian patients with non-small cell lung cancer. It was effective because it was in Asian patients. A good number of patients already had an EGFR mutation, but it was not selected for EGFR mutated patients. But the benefit of the gefitinib, now we know, is only for EGFR mutated patients. So when you have a subgroup effect, the curves will always cross over. So initially it looks like the carboplatin is superior, but eventually the gefitinib is superior because these are the patients on gefitinib who were not EGFR mutated, but who got gefitinib, they had an inferior survival. Okay. The subgroup of patients who are EGFR not mutated and who got carboplatin did better. So initially the carboplatin looks better, but eventually because the EGFR group does really well, the gefitinib curve goes over that. Whenever you see a crossover, you must look for a subgroup. Okay, so when they originally did this trial, they did not know about the subgroup. You will see similar curves when the original trial of cetuximab in colon cancer, but they didn't know about the KRAS mutation status. If there was a crossover, later when you reanalyze this papers, you found that the benefit was only for the wild type KRAS. So this is one interesting thing you can pick up from Kaplan-Meier curves. Okay. Then another thing is this clinically significant, statistically insignificant. There are many examples for this. One very recent example is this pertuzumab trial in the adjuvant setting. So 92% versus 90%, because they had 4,000 patients on the trial, it was actually statistically significant, but actually the percentage is only 1%. Another example is erlotinib pancreatic cancer. The difference is very small, but statistically significant because you put huge number of patients on the trials. Clinically, it's irrelevant actually. Okay, and so I did say that don't look at too much into the tail of a curve, but sometimes you get some interesting information from the tail, provided you have enough patients available for follow-up. So here, the hazard ratio is important. Nivolumab was better than docetaxel, but also what is interesting is that there is a plateauing of the curve. So when we say plateauing, that means there is a proportion of patients who seem to be having long-term survival. There is no continued dip. So maybe a proportion who is having some kind of a functional cure. So just various things that you can gather from just looking at a curve, from a Kaplan-Meier curve. So it's a very nice graphical representation. So this is regarding the survival analysis. Now just one concept which I wanted to tell you was regarding this hazard ratio. So just wanted to convey that also. So to understand that, there are some terms which I want to tell. So absolute risk reduction or risk difference is the decrease in risk of a given treatment, right? Okay. So if the death rate after 1 month of voriconazole is 5%, 12% with placebo, the absolute risk reduction is 7%. It's very simple. Okay, what proportion you are reducing. The other concept you all must know is number needed to treat, which is just the inverse of the absolute risk reduction. Okay, so that is 1 by 0.07, 7% 0.07 is 14. That means if you treat 14 patients with voriconazole, you can save one life. Number needed to treat to save one life or to prevent one event. That's what the number needed to treat means. It is usually 1 by the absolute risk reduction. Okay, so that is easy to calculate. Now, when you are measuring outcomes, there are two types of things that we should know. One is the relative risk and the other one is odds ratio. This again, you all know, odds ratio in case control studies, relative risk in cohort studies. Cohort studies means you take a large cohort of patients, you take like 15,000 smokers, you 15,000 non-smokers, follow them up, how many develop smoking here, how many develop lung cancer here, how many develop lung cancer here. You compare, you get relative risk, and you tell this much extra risk. This is cohort study. Case control study, you take so many patients with lung cancer, you may be taking it to many patients without lung cancer, and you go back and see how many of them smoke, how many of them did not smoke. That is case control study. Case to control, this to this. Both are done in oncology, okay? When the event is very rare, you do case control. When the event is very common, you do cohort studies. Understand, some very rare cancer, you cannot do cohort study, no? You don't know how many people will develop that particular event. But when some event is very common, you can take so many smokers and follow them up also. So these are two concepts very important. Case cohort is exposure to outcome, case control is outcome to exposure. All your randomized trials are in a way cohort studies. In a sense, they are cohort studies because you are giving some intervention looking for an outcome. In a sense, all randomized trials are kind of a cohort studies. Okay. Now, relative risk is incidence of outcome with exposure divided by incidence of outcome without exposure. Okay. The relative risk is more than 1, increased risk. Relative equal to 1, no increased risk. Relative less than 1, reduced risk. It's a very simple concept. There's nothing to get confused here. Okay. So if I say relative risk of 1.36, what is the correct interpretation of this? Anyone? These are all your options. Which is the correct interpretation of this? So risk of disease is increased by 36%. So this is the correct interpretation. Okay. Okay. One second. So what when you say relative risk of 0.80, what does it mean? Risk of is reduced by 20%. 3.3 increased by 230%. Good. Very good. Okay. So right. This we already covered. Okay. Now it's all relative. Okay, 3 times more likely to develop the outcome you are exposed to. If you start at 30%, the risk is increased to 90%. But if you start at 0.1%, the risk is increased to 0.3%. Okay, that's why it is relative, it is not absolute. Okay. So depends on how much risk is there in the beginning. If the risk is very small, risk is increased by 30% doesn't mean anything. Or 3 times doesn't mean anything. But the risk is already high, then it becomes much higher, this thing. Odds ratio, I'll just skip this. Now coming to hazard ratio. So this is a slightly different concept. It is, you may think intuitively it is the same. What it means is hazard of an event in a treatment arm divided by hazard in the control arm. Now the difference is hazard means it is not just occurrence of an event. You are not looking at how many relapses happened in new treatment versus how many relapses happened in the old treatment. Because again, in any survival analysis, the time is important. Okay, you are not just completing the study and said 100 relapses happened in A, 100 relapses happened in B, there is no difference. The 100 relapses in A happened after 2 years, whereas 100 relapses in B happened after 5 months. So you cannot just take the absolute number. Somehow you have to factor in the time also in a survival analysis. Understand? So that is what this hazard ratio means. Hazard ratio or hazard is the instantaneous event rate. That means the probability that an individual at a time point has an event, that is the chance of having an event, how much more than the person in the control arm. Okay, I'll tell you. So suppose these are the event rates in the placebo arm. This is the event rate in the atorvastatin arm. This is just an example. Okay. So number of events in atorvastatin is 100, number of events in placebo is 154. So overall there is a 36% reduction in the event. That's how you calculate, that is the hazard rate. Now, but at each time point you can calculate the hazard. So the probability that event in question has not happened here. So if you take somebody who is at a 2 year time point, they have not had an event, what is the chance that they will have an event at 2.1 year time point, or let's say 2.05 time point, or 2.001 time point, the next instant, what is the chance of their developing an event? Whereas in the other one, what is the chance that they will develop in the next possible event instead? Till 2 years, they have not had an event. So just after that, what is the risk of him having an event? So that is the hazard. You understand? It's not the risk of having the event at any point of time. At 2 years, he has not had an event. At next instant, what is the risk of his having an event? That is the hazard. And the hazard in the control arm and the hazard in the test arm. This is the hazard ratio. Hazard is the risk of having the event at the next point time point when they have not had the event till now. So the time is considered into the hazard, and it reflects the hazard ratio reflects the event possibility over the entire time proportion, not at any given point of time, over the entire proportion. Okay. So it is like the relative risk, but it's not always the same as relative risk. Okay. Anything here? So hazard is the instantaneous event rate. Okay, it is like a relative risk, but it incorporates time into it. Class effect. In this context.
I heard in some seminars, but I didn't understand.
I don't know in this context, I know exactly what you are asking, sorry. Okay, I think there are some slides, I think this you people know, this intention to treat analysis and subgroup analysis. I think, again, I just wanted to stop here because I just wanted to convey this hazard ratio. Again, it's an important short note, but from the understanding point of view, this is the difference. You want to incorporate time into it. Hazard ratio is used in the context of survival analysis along with the Kaplan-Meier curve, whereas relative risk and all those things you can use in any kind of study. You just take, okay, so many smokers, so many died, so many did not die, or just take that proportion, you can use relative risk. Okay, even in a trial, if you want to say so many died, so many did not die, you can always just say in terms of numbers, you don't need to use hazard ratio. But that is not sufficient because the time is important. When they died is important. So when you're lengthening the duration, that is important. So that's why the hazard ratio is important, not just so many died, so many did not die. If you take advanced lung cancer, give them Jefnib, you give them nothing, both groups, ultimately everybody will die. Nobody is going to live endlessly with advanced lung cancer even if you give Jefnib. But when they die, how much prolongation is there, that is important. So if you just take this many died, this many did not die, and you compare the numbers, you are not going to get your proportions correct. So that time has to be incorporated. That's where the hazard function comes. No, hazard ratio by itself, it's calculated with the time in the statistics for the hazard ratio incorporates the time in it. When you present the hazard ratio, you don't mention the time because the hazard ratio is constant for that entire period of time. You understand? That is the beauty of it. It is the risk for the entire period of time has been incorporated into one ratio. It's not like at 1 year the hazard ratio is different from those 2 year time point. The hazard ratio is same for that entire curve for that particular thing. There's no separate hazard ratio at first year, second year, third year. When I tell the hazard ratio is 1.5, at 1 year time point, this person has got 1.5 times the hazard as compared to the control person or the test person. And let's say the at 2 year time point, again, whatever the hazard is there for this is 1.5 times. At 3 year time point, whatever the hazard is there for this, it is 1.5 times. The hazard ratio is the same. It is not, hazard ratio does not change. Hazard ratio is averaged for the entire time period. Okay.
Any other questions?
Power and alpha, beta, I had some slides on that, but.
If you tell that, you might miss your bus.
Yeah, so I think I'll miss my bus.
I think he has to rush. So what I think, we'll share the slides.
Yeah, the slides have those things.
I think that one particular slide is very important, where he mentioned all the short notes probability. So you better be careful if you get your bus. Thank you so much. And he has been very active participant. So we'll see you next year. So.